Hello everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel, Dr. Markis Ophthalmology Tutorials. Today we will discuss about aqueous humor dynamics. Okay, in that we will see how the aqueous humor is formed, the detailed anatomy of the ciliary body and the ciliary processes, what are the factors which influence in the aqueous humor production, and also what are the instruments which are used to measure the aqueous humor production. Okay, so before going to aqueous humor dynamics, let me give my shout out to Purnima again, who has given correct answers to all the 5 questions which I had asked in my previous video. Congratulations, Purnima. I hope more number of students will take part in the question answer session from this video at least. Okay, so without much delay, let's begin our video. As you know, in glaucoma, IOP is the only modifiable risk factor which we know. And this IOP is majorly contributed by the aqueous humor. That's why we should know in detail about the aqueous humor production, the drainage system as well. Okay, aqueous humor is nothing but relatively cell-free and the protein-free fluid which is secreted from the ciliary body by the ciliary processes. Okay, so why this aqueous humor is produced? It has certain functions in the eye. It acts as blood to the certain avascular structures of the eye in the iris segment, like for the lens and the cornea. Okay, so it provides the nutrition in the form of glucose, amino acids. It provides potassium. It also removes the metabolic byproducts like carbon dioxide, lactic acid as well as pyruvic acid. So that is the major function of the aqueous humor. And secondly, it provides a clear optical medium so that the light rays can easily reach the retina. And the third is it will add volume to the eyeball, thereby giving a contribution to the intraocular pressure. And the aqueous humor is very rich in ascorbic acid, which will protect the eye against the free radicals as well as UV radiation damage. Okay, and last one, which is also most important thing, that is, and in case of inflammation and the infection, the aqueous humor acts as a medium for the transport of the components of cell mediated immunity as well as humoral mediated immunity. So these are the functions of aqueous humor. Now let's discuss the anatomy of the ciliary body. Okay, so this is the sclera. This is the sclera. Okay, it has a spur like thing here. This is called as the scleral spur, means it gives a invagination here. So this prominent part of the sclera is called as the scleral spur. Okay, and there is a cavity like thing here called as scleral sulcus. Okay, and this prominent point of the cornea, this is the corneal part, this is the scleral part. So this prominent part of the corneal endothelium is called as Schwalbe's line. Okay, so hope you understood all these structures. So the projection from the sclera is called as the scleral spur, which is there all over 360 degree, and there is an invagination, a cavity like thing called as scleral sulcus, and the prominent part in the endothelium of the cornea is called as the Schwalbe's line. Okay, and here your trabecular meshwork will be present. And coming to the ciliary body, if you take the cross section of the ciliary body, it almost resembles a triangle. So it's a triangular structure which is attached to the scleral spur here, with a potential space in between the sclera and the ciliary body called as supraciliary space. Okay, and so the iris gets inserted onto the anterior surface of your ciliary body like this. But there is a gap here. Can you appreciate this gap? So there is a gap between the scleral spur and the iris insertion. This is the ciliary body band which you see on corneoscopic examination. So hope the structures are clear now. So this iris along with the sclera and the cornea forms the angle that is called as angle of the anterior chamber. And when you visualize this angle of anterior chamber using corneoscope, you will see the following structure. So the first one is the prominent line of the Descemet's membrane called as Schwalbe's line. The second is the trabecular meshwork. The third is the scleral spur. Okay, that is the projection of the sclera. The fourth is the ciliary body band. Okay, and the final one is the iris, that is the root of the iris. So these are the structures which you visualize on corneoscopic examination. So coming to the anatomy of the ciliary body proper. So the ciliary body has 3 components. It has muscles in this, okay, vessels, that is the vascular component, as well as the epithelium. Okay, and the ciliary body can be divided into 2 parts, that is the pars plana part, which is posterior, and the anterior one is called as pars plicata, because it has so many foldings, infoldings like this of the ciliary processes. This is called as ciliary processes. Okay, Coming to the muscles of the ciliary body, we have longitudinal muscles, the circular muscles, as well as the radial muscles. Okay, so the longitudinal muscles are also called as the meridional muscles. So coming to attachment of these longitudinal muscles, anteriorly it is attached to the scleral spur as well as some part of the trabecular meshwork. Posteriorly it goes in the supracoroidal lamina, attaching some part of the choroid to the sclera as far as the equator of the globe. So this is the longitudinal muscle of the ciliary body. The contraction of this muscle leads to opening of the trabecular meshwork. Okay, the second group of muscle is the circular muscle. Okay, so these are the circular muscle which run circumferentially along the limbus. So contraction of these circular muscle leads to relaxation of the zonules and leading to change in the shape of the lens, which is a component of the accommodation. And third fibers are called as the radial fibers, which are known to connect these two muscles, that is the circular muscle as well as the longitudinal muscles are connected by this radial muscle. And the function of this radial muscle is not very clear. What is postulated is contraction of this muscle will lead to opening of the uveal trabecular spaces. This is about the muscles of the ciliary body. Coming to the blood supply of the ciliary body, it is from the two long posterior ciliary arteries. Okay, so which will enter the globe near the optic disc and then comes along the sclera, and at the limbus it forms an arcade. Okay, the two long posterior ciliary arteries unite to form major arterial arcade. Okay, which will provide the blood supply to the. So as I told, the ciliary body has two parts, that is the pars plicata part and the pars plana part. So this pars plicata has numerous ciliary processes. Okay, so if you take each ciliary process, it measures around 2 mm in length, okay, 0.5 mm in width and 0.9 mm in height. And if you take the surface area of all these ciliary processes together, it is more than the surface area of the endothelium or the posterior surface of the cornea. So it is such a large surface which is formed to help in the process of production of the aqueous humor. This is the pars plicata part of the ciliary body, which has numerous ciliary processes. So if you take one ciliary process and enlarge at C, we have three major parts in each ciliary process. The most thing is the capillary core, the next to it is the stroma of the ciliary process, and next to it is the epithelium of the ciliary process. In epithelium, you have two types here, the outermost, okay. So this is the outermost epithelium, which is pigmented. So the outermost is the pigmented epithelium and the inner one is the non-pigmented epithelium, okay. And these two, pigmented and the non-pigmented epithelium, are connected to each other by the apical region. See, the apical regions are opposing to each other and the basal lamina is present on either side of this epithelium. And there is a potential space between these two epithelial cells, that is the pigmented epithelium as well as the non-pigmented epithelium, called as the ciliary channel, okay, to which all your ions and the water come and collect and then get into the posterior chamber. And within each epithelial layer, between the epithelium of the pigmented layer as well as between the epithelium of the non-pigmented layer, we have gap junctions, puncta aderentia as well as the desmosomes. Okay, these two, puncta aderentia and the desmosome, helps to keep this epithelium attached to each other. Okay, it will give a structural support to the epithelium of the ciliary process. Whereas this gap junction is a low resistance area which will facilitate the movement of ions as well as the fluid. Okay, so this gap junction, puncta aderentia and the desmosomes are seen within the epithelial layer. In between the epithelial layer as well as within the non-pigmented epithelium, we have one more thing called as tight junction. Okay, so this tight junction is very important in your aqueous humor formation. Okay, so hope the anatomy of the ciliary processes is clear now. The ciliary process has very rich blood supply. If the blood volume is compromised to some extent, it will not affect the flow of blood into the ciliary processes as well as the aqueous humor formation. But if there is more than 30% reduction in the blood volume in a person, then it will lead to compromise in the blood supply to the ciliary processes, thereby leading to compromise in the aqueous humor production. So anything which affects the blood supply of the ciliary process will affect the aqueous humor production. Suppose if there is a vasoconstriction, like from the alpha adrenergic drugs, it can lead to decreased aqueous production. If there is vasodilatation, like following increased carbon dioxide or paracentesis or even the parasympathetic stimulation, can lead to increased aqueous humor production. So in the process of aqueous humor formation, we have three main parts, that is the ultrafiltration, active transport or the active secretion, and the diffusion. Okay, So what is ultrafiltration? By definition, it is the process of movement of ion as well as the fluid across the semipermeable membrane along the pressure gradient. Okay. So what happens here is, in the ciliary process, which has a tremendous blood supply in the capillaries, that is almost to the tune of 150 microliters per minute. So even if the 4% of this plasma get filtered, so it will come to the stroma and then between the epithelial cells and then enters into the posterior chamber. But this alone is not sufficient for the formation of the aqueous humor, which is seen. So that is added by your active transport or the active secretion. So what happens in the active transport or the active secretion, which is a energy dependent process, and there is movement of the ions against the pressure gradient. Okay. So some of the ions will pass from the capillary network. Okay. So they will come out of the capillaries and pass through this stroma and then come between the epithelial cells, passing the tight junction, and then get connected between the interepithelial clefts by means of your sodium potassium ATPase pump, which are active in the epithelium of the ciliary process. So because of this movement of the ions, it will create an osmotic pressure gradient, which will draw the fluid along with these ions. So these are the sodium which gets secreted by this active transport or the active secretion, and because of the osmotic pressure gradient, it will draw the fluid along with this. And there one more component is the bicarbonate, which is formed by means of your carbonic anhydrase enzyme. Okay, the carbonic anhydrase enzyme, which is very much present in the ciliary process, leads to the formation of bicarbonate, which also is osmotically strong and draws the fluid, so thereby forming the aqueous humor in the posterior chamber. So you saw, along with the sodium and the bicarbonate, water was coming to the posterior chamber. Now there is one more thing called as the aquaporins, which are independent of these ions. So these are the protein substances which are present in the cell membrane, which themselves will draw the fluid into the posterior chamber. Okay. And one more thing which is secreted actively into the posterior chamber is the ascorbic acid. Okay. So these are the components of your active transport. That is the sodium and the water, bicarbonate along with the water, and the aquaporins, which are readily permeable to the water, and the ascorbic acid. Third one is the diffusion. It is nothing but along with the pressure gradient, the substances or the ions will move and reach the aqueous humor. Okay, so this is about the diffusion. So we have three components in the aqueous humor formation, that is the ultrafiltration, active transport or the active secretion, and the diffusion. Though the aqueous humor is formed out of your plasma, since there are so many processes which are involved in the aqueous humor formation, like ultrafiltration, active transport, and the diffusion, the composition of the aqueous humor compared to plasma is slightly different. Okay, so when you compare with the plasma, the sodium, chloride, potassium, and the bicarbonate in the aqueous humor is almost similar to the plasma concentration, whereas ascorbic acid, pyruvate, and the lactate are more in the aqueous humor compared to plasma, but the glucose and phosphate are less in the aqueous humor compared to plasma. The pH of the aqueous humor is 7.21, whereas the pH of the plasma is 7.4. So coming to one of the important clinical aspects, that is the blood aqueous barrier. So this is nothing but the things which are preventing the contents of the blood to move towards the aqueous or the aqueous humor. So as you saw, the ciliary process has the capillary endothelium, okay, the stroma, as well as the basement membranes of the epithelium and the epithelium per se. All these are acting as the barriers. But the important one is the tight junction, which are present between the epithelial layers of the ciliary processes as well as in the non-pigmented epithelium of the ciliary process. So tight junctions play an important role in the blood aqueous barrier function. Okay. So there are so many factors which will lead to breach in the blood aqueous barrier, like any form of trauma, the chemical injuries, when you do paracentesis, following the infection or the inflammation of the eye, even following the irradiation of the eye, this blood aqueous barrier is breached. So what happens when there is breach in the blood aqueous barrier? There is increased movement of the protein into the aqueous humor. Okay, it will lead to mild amount of the meiosis. There is increased flux of the white blood cells into the anterior chamber. Okay, and can be transient rise in IOP followed by the hypotomy. Okay, so processes which will happen when there is breach in the blood aqueous barrier. So is this breach in the blood aqueous barrier is helpful or harmful to the eye? In some cases, like in case of infections, okay, so this breach in the blood aqueous barrier will lead to increased components of the cell mediated immunity as well as humoral mediated immunity in the aqueous humor, thereby leading to healing or the protection against this infection. But in some of the cases of inflammation, like in case of uveitis, this process may lead to the complications like cataract or even the cyanide formation. Mechanisms which are involved in this breach in blood aqueous barrier are the prostaglandins as well as some of the neural peptides like substance P. So these play a major role in the breaching blood-aqueous barrier. Coming to the aqueous humor production and the measurement of the aqueous humor production. This is just for the sake of completion. So normally the aqueous humor is produced at the rate of 2 to 3 microliters per minute. Okay. So we have certain methods to measure the production of this aqueous humor. Like depending upon the pressure gradient, we can measure using tonography, suction cups or by the perfusion. When we are using tracer elements, okay. So by that we can measure the aqueous humor production. In that we are using fluorescent or fluorescent-aided dextran or para-aminohiparate, PAH and the iodides. So these can be used to measure the aqueous humor production. What is the normal volume of aqueous humor in the anterior chamber? It is around 2.5 ml, whereas in the posterior chamber it is around 0.6 ml. Okay. So let's see some of the factors which will influence the aqueous humor formation. Like it is decreased following the hypothermia, acidosis, using hyperosmotic agents in case of diabetes patients, the RD or the retinal detachment and the choroidal detachment, following cyclodestructive procedures, the aqueous humor production is decreased. So the opposite is the condition where it is increased, like in case of hyperthermia, alkalosis, when you are using hypoosmotic agents, and even the usage of the calcium can increase the aqueous humor production. So coming to the agents which will decrease the aqueous humor production, that is the drugs. So we have vasopressin, halothane, barbiturates, okay, beta adrenergic blockers, as well as the alpha adrenergic agonist and the carbonic anhydrase inhibitors can decrease the production of aqueous humor. And the aqueous humor production is increased by beta adrenergic agonist, okay, systemic usage of the corticosteroids as well as the pilocarpine, which can slightly increase the aqueous humor production. So this is all about your aqueous humor formation, the factors which are influencing the aqueous humor formation, the ciliary body anatomy, the ciliary process anatomy. So everything in detail about the aqueous humor dynamics. So the questions for this video are, name the angle structures visualized on gonioscopy. Which structure is important in maintaining blood-aqueous barrier? What is the pH of aqueous humor? Which substances are more in aqueous humor compared to plasma? Name the drugs which decrease the aqueous humor production. So please do leave your answer in the comment section. So hope this video was useful to all of you. If you find my videos are useful to you, please do subscribe to my channel. Press the bell icon for further notification. Please do like and share my videos. Thank you so much.